When I was at school, I studied French and I took part in an exchange with a French family. On the flight back, a conversation began with the woman sitting next to me, during which she asked me, "What is your opinion of Jesus?" I mumbled in reply because at that stage of my life, I had no real opinion, and I felt a bit awkward about that. I didn't grow up with much teaching about Jesus, just a little bit at school, nothing to speak of at home particularly, and I was perhaps 11 or 12 years old. It was only later, when I was 14, that I started to hear the Bible taught and explained at my senior school. And that question on the plane was a great question for me, so let me ask it to you. What is your opinion of Jesus? We're all on a journey through life. Some of you are in your childhood, at the beginning of that journey. Others have been going a long time. On the journey, we discover different things that interest us. Some we get bored of quickly. Others engage us for a while, but then we move on as we grow up. But some things are of lasting and enduring value. And I found that Jesus is in that last category. He grows more important and more precious to me as the years go on. There's no one like him. Today we're asking the question, who is Jesus? And there's no more important question to ask. And with that, there's no better place to look for an answer than in Mark's gospel. Mark discovered what a special person Jesus was, and he wanted to enable others to discover that as well. So he wrote this short biography of Jesus' life to enable us to find out about him. I wonder if Mark ever imagined that millions of copies of his book would be printed in languages all around the world, or that it would become instantly accessible through the internet. I wonder if he ever imagined that in the year 2021, we would still be reading his book here in Colchester, on the outskirts of what was then the Roman Empire, of which he was part. Mark's gospel informs us so that you and I can have an opinion about Jesus. And if you have sight of a Bible, please do find that passage which we've just heard read by Jenny, Mark chapter 1. We'll look at a couple of details in different verses as we go through. I want us to explore four answers to the question, who is Jesus? Each answered by a different person. And we begin with Mark himself. Who is Jesus according to Mark? Mark tells us who he thinks Jesus is in his very first sentence. Please look at chapter 1, verse 1. The beginning of the gospel about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Mark tells us that Jesus is the Christ, God's Son. Well, that's a big statement to start things off, isn't it? This is a summary of what Mark wants to teach us about Jesus through his whole book. Mark calls Jesus the Christ, and that can also be translated as Jesus the Messiah. Christ and Messiah both mean the same thing. Christ is a translation from the Greek language, and Messiah from the Hebrew language. So Christ Messiah was a title for the long-expected leader that God was going to give to his people. Israel was waiting for a leader, a king, in the line of Old Testament King David, a descendant of Ruth and Boaz, who we'll be focusing on in a few Sundays' time. Son of God was another way of describing this long-awaited rescuer king. According to Mark, Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And this means that according to Mark, Jesus is a king. Mark calls his biography of Jesus gospel, the beginning of the gospel about Jesus Christ. And the word gospel means good news. Mark's book is a good news story. But it's a bit more specific than any old good news story. It's an official announcement that the true King from God has come. Paul Barnett, in his book, The Servant King, explains that inscriptions from the time showed that when important news about a Roman emperor was announced, it was called good news. The Greek word was euangelion, and this word was used for good news announcements. A king coming to power, a king winning a battle. An inscription from 29 BC, so about 30 years before Jesus was born, there's an inscription about the Roman Emperor Augustus, and it's strikingly similar to the opening of Mark's Gospel. It says this: "The birthday of the God marked for the world the beginning of good tidings through his coming." So they considered the Emperor Augustus, his birth, they considered him to be a god. The birthday of the god, i.e. Augustus, marked for the world the beginning of good tidings, gospel, through his coming. This gospel declared that a new age of peace for the war-torn Roman world had begun with the birth of Augustus. Well, Mark understands Jesus as God's true king on the world stage, among the kings and powers and emperors of the world. To put it in today's context, that would be rulers like President Erdogan of Turkey, Joe Biden, imminent president of America, Kim Jong-un of Korea, and of course our own Prime Minister, Boris Johnson. The difference is that they are mostly elected. Jesus was not elected. He's a king, not a president. So who is Jesus according to Mark? Jesus is Christ the King, the Son of God. Secondly, who is Jesus according to Isaiah's prophecy? Mark begins his gospel with a quotation from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. Isaiah prophesied about 700 years before Jesus' birth. Mark understands Isaiah's prophecy to have been fulfilled in the lives of John the Baptist and Jesus. The words of Isaiah tell us John the Baptist's job description, verse 3. "He's a voice of one calling in the desert, 'Prepare the way for the Lord.'" So John the Baptist's job was to point away from himself and to get people ready for the arrival of Jesus the Lord. Lord is another word for someone who's in charge, a ruler, a leader. And here's the amazing thing. It's a little bit detailed, so you'll need to focus. When you go back to the book of Isaiah and find the original quote, chapter 40, verse 3, it turns out that Isaiah was talking about preparing the way, not for any old Lord, but preparing the way for God. Lord in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, is written in capital letters, L-O-R-D. In English Bibles, Lord in capitals signifies a translation of the Hebrew name for God, Yahweh. So Mark tells us that these words, spoken 700 years before Jesus' birth, were a prophecy about Jesus, meaning that Jesus is Yahweh, the Lord. Jesus, according to Isaiah's prophecy, was God walking and talking as a human being. We've just celebrated this wonderful good news over the Christmas season, remembering the Christmas baby in the manger who was the exact representation of God's being. So according to Isaiah's prophecy, Jesus is more than a man. He's Yahweh, the God revealed in the Old Testament. According to Isaiah's prophecy, Jesus is God. And that's how Mark starts his gospel, his introduction to this amazing person. Let's pause for a moment and respond in song to the truths about Jesus' identity that we've just heard. Jesus is Christ the King, and he's more than an ordinary king. He's God and worthy of our worship. return to our identity question. Thirdly, who is Jesus according to John the Baptist? As we heard in the Isaiah prophecy, God sent John the Baptist to prepare the way for Jesus' coming. And John became very famous in Israelite culture. The whole Judean community went out into the desert to listen to his preaching and to humbly receive baptism as a sign that they were sorry for their sins. Now, a pair of sandals can help us to understand who Jesus is according to John the Baptist. Please have a look with me at verse 7 to see John's opinion of Jesus. After me will come one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie. Now, I'm not suggesting that Jesus wore glittery sandals like these. These were the only ones that I could find in the house last night. But John is basically saying that Jesus is much more important than he is himself. John used a servant image to explain his low status compared to Jesus. He, John, isn't even worthy to do the most humble task for Jesus, untying and taking off his shoes. It's an expression, a turn of phrase, isn't it? John goes on in verse 8. I baptize with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Again, John is much less important than Jesus. John's baptism used ordinary water, just like our baptisms do today. But Jesus will baptize with God's Holy Spirit. And again, this speaks of Jesus' divine power and authority. So who is Jesus according to John the Baptist? Jesus is the Holy Spirit baptizer, who's much more important in God's purposes than John is. Finally, who is Jesus according to God the Father? In chapter 1, verses 9 to 11, Jesus travels from Nazareth, where he lived, to the River Jordan so that he could be baptized by John. And when Jesus is baptized, an amazing thing happens. A voice from heaven speaks and says, verse 11, "You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." This is God speaking, God the Father. And these words are very important because they tell us who God thinks Jesus is. God the Father tells us that Jesus is his son, that he loves him, that he's very pleased with him. God could have given any message at that moment, but these are the three things that he declared. And this connects with Mark's opening line where he wrote that Jesus is the Son of God. Now, I explained earlier that Son of God was another way of saying God's special King, the Christ. But when we put this together with God the Father's words at Jesus' baptism and the words from Isaiah's prophecy, we can see that Jesus is much more than just a regular Israelite king. Jesus is the Son of God in a special way, beyond all the previous kings of Israel. At Jesus' baptism, we see God the Trinity in action. Jesus is in the Jordan River with John, and as Jesus comes up out of the water, heaven is torn open, and the Spirit comes down on him like a dove. Old Testament kings were anointed with olive oil on the head to mark the moment when they became king. The titles Christ and Messiah literally mean anointed one, because anointing with oil was the symbol of appointing someone as a king. The oil was a symbol of the king being anointed with the Holy Spirit to give him power to rule well and to rule wisely. When Jesus came up out of the water, God the Father anointed him with the Holy Spirit as a sign to us of his kingship. Verse 10 tells us that John saw heaven torn open and the Spirit descending on him, Jesus, like a dove. In the baptism of Jesus, we see God the Trinity in action in a special way. God the Father speaks and sends the Holy Spirit. The Spirit descends on Jesus, and Jesus is baptized by the Spirit. The three persons of the Trinity are all there, but they aren't identical. Each has a different role. Was God the Father baptized? No, he wasn't. Was the Spirit baptized? No, Jesus was baptized. Did Jesus send the Spirit? No, he didn't. Did the Spirit send the Father? No. Did the Spirit come down on Jesus? Yes. The three persons of the Trinity are all present, but they aren't identical in their actions. We see them interacting, and we see their distinct roles. And this tells us something about the Trinity. One God, but three persons. God the Father tells us that Jesus is his beloved Son, and he anoints him with the Holy Spirit as a sign to us of Jesus' kingship. So who is Jesus according to God the Father? Jesus is his Son. He loves him and he approves of him. So in summary, as I come to the end of this talk, in the first chapter of Mark's Gospel, we've seen four answers to the question, who is Jesus? Four answers from different perspectives, but all together revealing Jesus' identity. According to Mark, Jesus is Christ the King, the Son of God. His coming is good news. According to Isaiah's prophecy, Jesus is the Lord, L-O-R-D in capital letters, meaning God, known by the name Yahweh. According to John the Baptist, Jesus is the Holy Spirit baptizer, who's much more important than he, John, is. And according to God the Father, Jesus is his Son. He loves him and he's really pleased with him. As a schoolboy, on that flight returning from France, I didn't have a clear opinion about Jesus. But as I started to hear the Bible explained later on in my teenage years, an opinion started to form. And these four explanations of Jesus' identity show us that each of us can have an opinion about Jesus. If the great God of heaven loves Jesus, it shows us that we should love him as well. If God the Father is pleased with Jesus, then we should be pleased with Jesus as well and delight in him. Our next song helps us to do that.